The mammalian skull is made of a number of different bones fused together to form a protective case around the brain. Bones of the skull also form the face and the mouth. Because it houses sensory organs, plays a role in feeding, and supports many other functions from communication to protection, skulls can be valuable sources of information about the ecology and evolution of animals. For example, herbivores such as this camel have a broad, rounded jaw to attach strong muscles for chewing and grinding plant material. Their molars and premolars are often flat. Canine teeth are often small or absent, and incisors can be long and capable of clipping and shearing vegetation. There is also typically a gap called a diastema between the incisors and premolars. Some gnawing herbivores have chisel-like incisors that grow throughout the life of the animal, as can be seen in this hair. Carnivores, such as this lion, have prominent canine teeth to puncture and capture prey. Premolars and molars of carnivores can be modified into shearing, scissor-like teeth called carnassial teeth that can tear and shred meat. Omnivores, such as this raccoon, or even humans, have a more multi-purpose set of teeth. They eat a combination of plant and animal tissue in their diets and have a combination of chewing molars and sharp incisors and canines so they can tear, crush, and otherwise process their food. To investigate the structural and functional features of the skull, it is necessary to know its major bones and features. This will be indicated on the human skull shown here. First, a skull is composed of two major parts, the cranium and the mandible, or jaw. From the front, it is possible to see the frontal bone, nasal bone, zygomatic bone, and the maxilla. The brow ridge is above the orbit where the eye is attached. The other large opening is the nasal cavity. In side view, you can see the frontal bone, parietal bone, temporal bone, which attaches to the zygomatic bone to form the zygomatic arch, and finally, the sphenoid bone. In the very back of the skull is the occipital bone. From the rear of the skull, you can see the two parietal bones fused along a suture. There is also a prominent suture where the occipital bone fuses to the parietals. Another important feature observed in skulls is the position of the opening where the spine attaches and the spinal cord enters to connect with the brain. The foramen magnum is positioned more centrally or at a greater distance from the back of the skull in bipedal animals that walk upright, such as humans. The curved depression in the temporal bone is called the mandibular fossa, and it forms part of the hinge with the jaw. The zygomatic arch, formed by fusion of the zygomatic and temporal bones, protects the eye and provides a passage for some chewing muscles and attachment points for others. And finally, the palate that forms the roof of the mouth can be seen here, as well as the opening to the nasal cavity. The mandible has three key features: the hinge-forming mandibular condyle and two areas of muscle attachment, the ramus and the coronoid process. The mandibular condyle and the fossa form the temporomandibular joint, or TMJ. When we compare herbivore and carnivore skulls, we see differences in the hinge formed at the TMJ and the location of the teeth line. Typically, the TMJ is higher above the teeth line in herbivores than in carnivores. This gorilla skull shows other important features. A prominent ridge called the sagittal crest runs down the middle of the skull from the front to the back, and a large occipital crest is present across the back. The large sagittal crest provides a large area for muscles to attach to the jaw and generate tremendous biting and chewing power. The large occipital crest also provides a large area for neck and back muscles to attach to the skull. When comparing homologous structures between the gorilla and human skull, it is possible to see how the foramen magnum is located farther to the back of the skull in the gorilla, which walks on all four limbs, as compared to the upright walking human, where the foramen magnum is located more centrally in the bottom of the skull. Also notice the longer palate in the gorilla skull, which indicates a more projecting face than in the humans. The gorilla skull, when looked at in side view, also shows a prominent brow ridge, a more angled face, and a small, elongate brain case. The human skull, in contrast, is flatter, has a reduced brow ridge, and a large, rounded brain case. Qualitative comparisons of homologous skull features can provide useful data for evolutionary studies. However, it is also possible to collect quantitative data to more precisely compare size and shape relationships of skull bones and study evolutionary relationships among species. Cranial breadth can be measured by placing two rulers at the widest part of the cranium and then placing a third ruler flat across the top of the skull. The distance between them indicates the width of the brain case. Facial breadth is similarly measured by placing two rulers at the maximum distance between the lateral surfaces of the cheekbones, or zygomatic arches, and measuring the distance between them. Cranial length is measured by placing one ruler against the back of the skull and a second ruler just behind the brow ridge and measuring the distance between them. Skull length is measured by placing one ruler at the back of the skull and the other at the edge of the maxilla. Facial projection length can be measured by placing a ruler at the back of the auditory canal and measuring to the edge of the maxilla. The position of the foramen magnum can be measured by placing one ruler at the back of the skull and measuring to the back edge of the foramen magnum from the back of the skull. These measurements can be used for direct size comparisons among skulls or for calculating different indices, such as the cranial index, which describes the breadth and length relationship and overall shape of the brain case. Larger index values indicate a more round shape. The skull proportion index can be calculated to describe the proportional relationship between the face and cranium. The larger the index value, the larger the cranium is relative to the face. The facial projection index describes the relationship between the face and overall skull length. Higher values indicate a more muzzle-like face with a longer nose and mouth. The foramen magnum index indicates position of the opening relative to the back of the skull. Higher values indicate a more centrally located foramen magnum that is characteristic of bipedal walking organisms, or lower values indicating position more typical of quadrupeds. Calculation of these values not only makes it possible to study and compare skulls of existing species, but they also allow us to make comparisons with fossils of extinct species and explore the history of different lineages.